we have gently introduced subsidy reforms, and as a result, our capital expenditures this year have improved very significantly, and which will have a multiplier effect in the economy as we go on into the next 6 months of this financial year. While many commentators had expressed doubt, I've spent nearly 2 years in this department now, but we have, as I said, simultaneously achieved a 10% increase in tax devolution to the states through the 14th Finance Commission Award. We've achieved over 30% increase in the plan CapEx, which I just mentioned, and yet adhere to this fiscal consolidation, which has been outlined in the budget. I believe such a feat has never been achieved in the past. We continue to work together on rationalizing central sector schemes and programs in the run-up to the budget for 2016-17. A lot of groundwork has been done on that, and we've been working very closely with the Niti Aayog on this. To give adequate time to the ministries and departments to reform their financial processes this year, in fact, the pre-budget exercise has been moved forward by 2 months. Normally, we used to start work at the end of October, but we are already full swing into the preparatory exercises. And this will perhaps help us to work in better coordination and be better prepared for the forthcoming budget exercise. The other details will be mentioned in the press release, which will be handed over to you. And this conference also, I am glad that we are holding it today, is because it is on the eve of the departure of the Secretary of Economic Affairs, who will be leaving tonight for the World Bank IMF annual meeting at Lima. And we have representatives from all the departments over here. Mrs. Anjali Duggal couldn't come because she's busy in a meeting with the RBI on some interviews. And Mrs. Johri is already on a roadshow outside. She's out of the country. She couldn't come. But we have her representatives over here if there are any questions which arise. And all of us will be looking at questions pertaining to economic affairs and anything related with revenue, DEA, disinvestment. In fact, I would think that perhaps a few remarks are made by the concerned secretaries, then we can take the questions. I'd probably welcome Mr. Das to say a few remarks, and after that, the revenue secretary, the CEA, and then we can take the questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning to all of you. To open the remarks and to open the discussion, and before we take on the questions, I just would like to say and supplement what the finance secretary has said, that the government is poised to continue with the process of fiscal consolidation and achieving the fiscal deficit targets which have been set for the current year, and the overall fiscal roadmap which the finance minister had spelled out in his budget speech this year. Second point is that the growth is well under, is also poised, you know, we are poised, as a country, we are poised to exceed 7.5% this year. And the indications are that it will. We have a situation where the government has been taking number of decisions in the last 1 year, 1.5 years or so. And especially in the current financial year, it's almost every week or every 10 days some major decisions are taken. The government has been working with the financial institutions and the banks, and we are very happy to note that the banking system and the banks have also responded positively to the rate cut, and they have reduced the their own, you know, they have passed on, transmitted the rates by about 40 basis points, SBI and others, in the range of 25 to 30 basis points. So this should have a positive impact on various sectors of the economy, housing, consumer goods, automobiles, and basically several other sectors. And the low inflation, which also has been achieved and which is at the moment the trends are that this will continue. The low inflation and the low international commodity prices also give a policy opportunity to the government to continue with the process of economic reforms. Large number of decisions have been taken in the last several months by the government. I don't want to list them one by one because that's all known to you. So I'll stop at this point of time just by saying that the fiscal deficit targets, the growth numbers, all seem to be whatever were projected in the budget. We are quite optimistic that they will be achieved in the current year.
Good afternoon, friends. First of all, let me give you some update about the figure of revenue collection so far in India. Last year, that is 2014-15, the actual collection of taxes, both direct as well as indirect, was 12.4 lakh crore. That was the actual collection last year. The target this year is 14.45 lakh crore. That is the target this year, which is a growth rate of 16.5% over the actual collection last year. So the targeted growth rate of revenue in the current year is 16.5%. What was the actual achievement last year? In last year, we had achieved a direct tax growth rate of 9% and indirect tax growth rate of 9.9%. So in a way, the target looks to be ambitious. But I'm happy to say that the revenue position so far has been very, very satisfactory. The growth rate in income tax, in the direct taxes, up to the end of September is about 12% compared to the corresponding period last year. It is a growth of 12% in the corresponding period. And in growth of indirect tax, the actual growth rate, I have the figures only up to August because in indirect tax we get it on 7th of every month. So indirect taxes figure I'm giving you is only up to August, while direct taxes I'm giving you up to September. In indirect tax, up to August, if you exclude the additional resource mobilization efforts made, which is the new taxes or new duties which are levied during the year, if you exclude those additional resource mobilization efforts and compare like to like with the corresponding period last year, the growth rate so far is 12.2%. But if we take into account the additional resource mobilization also of the additional taxes which are levied this year, then the growth in indirect tax is 36.5%, so which is quite satisfactory. So there is likely to be some shortfall in the direct taxes when we end up the year, but some part of it will be made good by the indirect taxes because of the ARM, additional resource mobilization measures. And I am very hopeful that if there is no other externality which comes in, we should be able to achieve our target. Only the shortfall may be not more than 7%, or maybe around 5% shortfall may be there. So in the target of 4.5 lakh crore, we hope to achieve the entire target, at least, 14.5 lakh crore, we hope to achieve at least the revenue figure of 14 lakh crore. This is the current estimate. But if the year is good and we are already seeing a lot of demand, in fact, you can say that the growth of indirect taxes is actually a good indication of demand being generated in the market now. And so goods are being sold and goods are being consumed, so they are being imported, people are paying excise on it. The service tax is also showing some kind of a buoyancy. So all this is looking good. The second information I have to give you upfront is that in case of black money disclosure, the figure that we had declared, 638 cases, an amount of 3,770 crore, which was disclosed by people under the compliance window. Now, the figure of number of cases remains the same, but unfortunately, on that day, last day, some of the envelopes had come from various places all over the country because they just could not do it online or for whatever reason. So those envelopes which came in sealed cover in some other offices, they reached us after that, although those numbers were counted, the number of envelopes were counted. But the amount which is disclosed in that, it has made some difference. So now the total amount disclosed is 4,147 crore of amount declared by them, as against the figure of 3,770, which was disclosed earlier. So there's a marginal improvement in the amount, although the figure of declarants remains the same. These are the only two things I want to talk to you, then we can take questions. Thank you.
So we can take the questions. Please raise your placards. Okay, let's start from 36.
Good morning, sir. I'm Ruchi Bhatia from ET Now. You've mentioned that the direct tax collections, there's going to be some amount of shortfall. Add to that, the disinvestment target, currently we're pretty short of the target, the 69,500 crores target that we have set out. Where do we stand in terms of, how do you see our fiscal consolidation path for this year and for next year, given the shortfall? And in terms of disinvestment, we had all also said that there's going to be a lot of like about 21,000 crores was supposed to come from strategic stake sales. So where are we in terms of strategic stake sales?
Just let me mention that this fiscal consolidation exercise is an ongoing process. I mentioned also doubts had been raised last year that whether we'd be able to achieve our fiscal consolidation target or not. In fact, that's why this reviews have been done. Mr. Adhya has taken an initial assessment of what the likely revenue collections are going to be. Mrs. Jory, recently we sat together and had a look at the disinvestment figures. And while that doesn't mean that these are the final figures, there could be improvements. In fact, like last year, as I said, there were windfall gains. Suddenly we had telecom coming in and the target was 4.1 and we eventually ended up achieving 4.0. This year also, I may also state upfront that from the expenditure point of view, like last year, we do not want to go in for any over-rationalization or what you might term expenditure cuts. We want to sustain whatever has been envisaged in the plan of this year, both in the CSS schemes and the central sector schemes. That's why this exercise of looking at things on a zero-budgeted base exercise, every department where savings can be made without really cutting expenditures, that has been going on. I'm already also anticipating the Expenditure Management Commission to come up with some suggestions. In fact, they were supposed to finalize the report by the end of the year. That exercise has been going on also, where I believe some very good suggestions are going to be made about how you need not necessarily save by cutting. You can also save by just better management of money. And I believe that a lot of things, as I said, that's work in progress, can be done in that area. We still have time. These figures we look at, but all I can say is I'm confident that this 3.9% target will be achieved. And as mentioned, the way the growth figures, et cetera, which look like next year is going to be perhaps a good year, and the fiscal glide, what has been envisaged, will be sustained. If Arvind, you might want to say something.
On the disinvestment part of the question, I just wanted to mention that the finance minister has reviewed it last week, and I would not like to split disinvestment as to you know, strategic and non-strategic disinvestment. I would not like to get into that. Overall, the effort is to maximize the disinvestment receipt numbers. A strategy and a roadmap has been internally discussed, and all efforts are in that direction to maximize the collections under disinvestment. How much shortfall will be there? That is something which can be said at the end of the year, because the market is also, it's changing from day to day, but government is committed to maximize the receipts.
Yeah. You would like to ask?
Yeah. just want to add that at a time of, a lot of international uncertainty, turbulence, turmoil, I think it's, really essential that India be seen as a haven of macro stability and as a beacon of investment opportunities. So in that sense, acutely mindful of that, the government is absolutely committed, as the Finance Secretary and Economic Affairs Secretary said, absolutely committed to meeting this year's target, the glide path, and a point again emphasized by Finance Secretary that you want to do this without over-rationalizing expenditure, because that could also have an impact on growth going forward.
Yes, Cecil.
पहले सवाल का जवाब यह है कि ये इसका प्रोसेस मैं बता दूं आपको. 7th पे कमीशन का रिपोर्ट आएगी, उनको दिसंबर तक का टाइम दिया गया है. उन्होंने ही कुछ टाइम मांगा था आगे उसको करने के लिए. कुछ वो और एक्सरसाइजेस कर रहे हैं, इंटरनेशनल बेस्ट प्रैक्टिसेस वगैरह देख रहे हैं. जब रिपोर्ट आ जाएगी उसके बाद एक इम्प्लीमेंटेशन सेक्रेटेरिएट बनाया जाता है मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ फाइनेंस के अंदर, जिसके अंदर ये जो रिपोर्ट के रिकमेंडेशंस हैं उनको एग्जामिन करते हैं, और उसके बाद इसको फिर देखने के बाद कैबिनेट को ले जाया जाता है. तो जहाँ तक इस साल का सवाल है, इस साल के फिस्कल उसके ऊपर लोड नहीं पड़ेगा. हाँ, मगर हालांकि पहली जनवरी से लागू हो जाता है इसका रिकमेंडेशन, जो कुछ भी एक्सेप्ट होगा वो तो गवर्नमेंट का हक बनता है एक्सेप्ट करने के लिए. तो इसका इफेक्ट अगले साल होगा, मगर अब रिपोर्ट में क्या आएगा, हमने तो अपने सबमिशंस वहाँ कर दिए हैं, वो तो इंडिपेंडेंट एक बॉडी है, वो बताएगी क्या करना है. मगर हमने अपने सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट की तरफ से जो कंसर्न्स थे एक्सपेंडिचर मैनेजमेंट के, क्या चीज़ इसके अंदर सस्टेनेबल है, जो कुछ भी पूरा एक तरह से दिया जाता है अवार्ड पे कमीशन का, वो आई एम श्योर दैट दी मेंबर्स एंड द चेयरमैन ऑफ दैट कमीशन आर फुली अवेयर ऑफ इट एंड दे विल बी सेंसिटिव टू आर कंसर्न्स आल्सो. दैट्स ऑल आई कैन से एट द मोमेंट. एंड दूसरा सवाल आई थिंक पैन कार्ड्स के ऊपर हसमुख आप.
I think the FM in his blog has already mentioned it in very correct words. He says we are in the advanced stage of finalizing this. He has said so. So I don't have to add anything more to that. You can understand the meaning of that. He has said that we are in the advanced stage of deciding the limit for giving PAN number, and we'll be announcing it as early as possible. That's what he has said.
Yeah, Deepshika.
This year, I don't envisage any problems in the, number one, the plan that has been made, as you've seen, it's smaller than what we were doing last year. It's reasonable, it's very well focused, there have been devolutions which have been made to the, which I had mentioned in the, under the 14th Finance Commission Award. And these are important areas, you know. Basically, the plan side is looking at social sector schemes, other areas which are very important. And normally, even in stressed circumstances, we never try to touch these. You know, of course, there's not enough funds to go around, but we never try to hurt these sectors. But what the good news is that I have the figures is that the way the money which was allocated for capital investment or capital expenditures has shown a significant jump, which I think will have a good multiplier effect, and we'd be able to sustain it in the coming year.
Yeah.
Arvind wants to say something. Sorry.
Answer to your question is that, you know, I don't know about 12, 13, 14, but part of the reason that used to happen or happened in 14, 15 was because the revenue estimates were highly, you know, over-optimistic. So in that sense, you know, it is not, unavoidable that some of these expenditure cuts happen. But this year, the big difference is, and what Revenue Secretary has said, that, you know, we're either very close or, you know, very small shortfall. So the revenue assumptions have been much more realistic this year, which makes the expenditure planning, you know, more realistic and feasible and implementable than in previous years.
Yeah.
Not yet.
Yeah, Lakshman.
Sir, Lakshman, CNBC Awaaz से. मेरा सवाल ये कि काला धन के स्कीम खत्म होने के बाद सरकार की तरफ से बयान भी आया कि जिन लोगों ने डिस्क्लोज नहीं किया उनके खिलाफ अब कार्रवाई की जाएगी, लेकिन ये विदेशों में रखे काले धन के खिलाफ कार्रवाई करने में भारत सरकार की तरफ से कितनी सीमाएं हैं, चूंकि इसमें सिर्फ आपके अधिकार क्षेत्र में आता नहीं है, ये चूंकि दूसरे देशों के साथ संधियां भी हुई हैं. और दूसरा सवाल, गोल्ड मोनेटाइजेशन स्कीम को कैबिनेट ने मंजूरी दे दी है, कब तक इसे लॉन्च होता देखेंगे?
I'll reply to the first question. Yes, ये बात सही है कि कालाधन बाहर से लाने के विषय में इंडिया की कुछ मर्यादा होती है. इंडिया, इंडियन गवर्नमेंट को दूसरे देशों के ऊपर डिपेंड करना पड़ता है. अभी हमारे पास जो ट्रीटी है, कुल मिला के 96 डबल टैक्स अवॉइडेंस एग्रीमेंट है, प्लस 14 हमारे पास स्पेसिफिक एक्सचेंज ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन की ट्रीटी है कुछ कंट्री के साथ. सो ये जो ट्रीटी है उसमें प्रावधान तो जरूर है कि अगर किसी का टैक्स इवेजन की बात हो और हमारे पास कुछ ठोस सबूत हो तो हम वो कंट्री को रिक्वेस्ट कर सकते हैं कि आप हमको इस आदमी का कोई अकाउंट के बारे में इंफॉर्मेशन दो. लेकिन जनरल प्रकार की इंफॉर्मेशन जो है रूटीन में जो हम मंगा, मतलब मान लो पूरी की पूरी इन्फॉर्मेशन मंगानी है कि भाई आप बताओ कि आपके कंट्री में हमारे देश के कितने लोगों के अकाउंट है, तो वो कंट्री डेफिनेटली वो अभी नहीं दे पाएंगे. लेकिन इसके लिए भी एक कॉमन रिपोर्टिंग स्टैंडर्ड की एक मल्टीलेटरल अरेंजमेंट अभी चल रही है, हो गई है, 50 से अधिक देशों ने इसको साइन कर लिया है. ऐसा है कि आप सब जानते हैं कि अमेरिका के साथ हमारा एक एग्रीमेंट हुआ है फटका, एन एग्रीमेंट कॉल्ड FATCA, फटका. नाउ अंडर दिस एग्रीमेंट द US गवर्नमेंट हैज़ ऑलरेडी स्टार्टेड गिविंग अस एंटायर इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट द बैंक अकाउंट्स एंड फ्लो ऑफ मनी इन टू द बैंक अकाउंट्स ऑफ इंडियन रेसिडेंट्स विच आर इन USA. दिस इन्फॉर्मेशन हैज़ ऑलरेडी कम टू अस स्टार्टिंग फ्रॉम 1st of October. वेल्थ ऑफ इन्फॉर्मेशन हैज़ कम टू अस फ्रॉम USA. ऑन द सिमिलर लाइन ऑफ फटका, दिस कॉमन रिपोर्टिंग स्टैंडर्ड मल्टीलेटरल अरेंजमेंट, इट इज़ बींग डिस्कस्ड, इट इज ऑलरेडी अग्रीड टू, एंड सम कंट्रीज आर ऑलरेडी अग्रीड टू बी द अर्ली अडॉप्टर्स ऑफ दिस. And that will be starting from 2017. India is one of the early adopters. So from 2017, many countries will agree to give regular flow of information about the accounts of other countries' nationals in their bank accounts. So this is going to come into being from 2017, when we will really get a big shot in our pursuit of finding out black money which is lying abroad. But in the meantime, whatever information we have got from whatever sources so far, we have been assessing them, we have been putting penalty on them, we have been filing prosecution, etc., and all these actions are taking. For example, in case of HSBC information which we had got, we already filed prosecution in 132 prosecutions in 43 cases. in case of HSBC. So a lot of action is happening in case of information which is already received by us. In terms of requesting information on specific cases to other countries, the number of such requests has gone up. It has doubled it has doubled in 1 year as compared to the last year. It has doubled. Almost 1,600 such requests have gone in 14-15 compared to 800 such requests which had gone in the previous year. So we are actually making a lot of requests for information to other countries where specific instances of tax evasion or tax avoidance are found. And we are working on assessing them, putting penalty, prosecution, whatever is required on them.
Yeah.
Sorry?
I'm Ashish Maharishi from CNN IBN. Why there was such a lukewarm response, as you know, many reports have suggested there are lakhs and lakhs of crores which are lying outside, and you've been able to garner only 4,000 odd crores?
Well, I don't think we had any target against which we can evaluate this response as lukewarm or very good. We didn't have any target to have in mind. Now, I don't want to comment about people's estimates. People might have made different kind of estimates from wherever. I don't have to say about that. But as far as this disclosure is concerned, we had no particular target in mind. It was an honest window of honest opportunity given to them. And if they want to come clean and honestly declare, then this is the opportunity which was given to them. I don't think we can we can say anything about it, you know, anything more than this.
Yeah, I'll come other, to most of you.
Other component. Yeah, the other component of the question on the gold scheme. You see, the gold. There are two components of the. There are two schemes. One is the gold bond scheme. The other one is the gold monetization scheme. We are working out the details. We have had our meetings with the Reserve Bank of India. Both the schemes will be launched during the month of November.
Yeah, 142. I'll come to most of you. Let's go one by one, patiently, please. Yeah.
देखिए फील्ड लेवल में तो इम्पैक्ट बिल्कुल है. आपने खुद बताया कि 189 से कुछ 140 या आपने कुछ नंबर बताया आपने, तो दैट इट्सेल्फ इज़ एन इम्प्रूवमेंट. फील्ड लेवल में काफ़ी सारे सुधार आए हैं, और ये जो हेल्दी कंपटीशन बिटवीन स्टेट्स जो है उसमें ऑल्सो मेनी स्टेट्स आर टेकिंग देयर ओन इनिशिएटिव टू सिंप्लीफाई द प्रोसेसेस एंड टू इम्प्रूव द ईज ऑफ डूइंग बिजनेस. फील्ड लेवल देर इज़ लॉट ऑफ इम्पैक्ट. You can get a new company can get registered. A new company can get registered through the corporate tax ministry's website in a matter of, I think, 3 to 4 days. He gets the PAN card in about 2 days. If it is the central excise registration, also it is done online now. The clearances, environment and other clearances are happening much faster. The customs clearances in the ports are also happening much faster. So field level mein bilkul impact hai. And this is demonstrated by the fact that FDI this year, the total FDI inflow this year is much larger than last year. This itself is a vote of confidence on the ease of doing business measures which the government is taking.
Can I just add, just one number to that? You know, the World Economic Forum recently released its competitiveness rankings. And there India actually improved 16 places, which, you know, over the space of 1 year, which apparently is quite dramatic and almost unprecedented. And then, of course, the FDI number that the Secretary just mentioned. And also, if you look at what's happening in terms of, you know, the number of companies which are either committed to or on the verge of, you know, investing in India, it seems to be quite an impressive list, you know, Xiaomi, Siemens, Baidu, and all these things. So in that sense, I think there are indications in the other direction as well.
Yeah.
So this is Mahua from Hindustan Times. So you said that, you know, 7.5% growth rate is what we are going to exceed, not only achieve, but exceed. Now, deficiency in rainfall, what impact will it have on the economy. And considering that banks have reduced rates by average 25 basis points to say 30 basis points, do you think that's enough? Considering again, RBI has come up with 125 basis points reduction to boost growth and
you see, earlier demand. The policy rates were reduced by about 75 basis points, against which the banks had transmitted about 30 basis points. Now against 40 basis points reduction by the RBI, the transmission ranges in the region of about 25 to 40 basis points. So that is the factual position, and this will definitely have an impact on the consumer markets, on housing and other sectors. So far as the impact of the deficiency in monsoon is concerned, the net area sown this year is marginally higher than the last year. What will be the season end production and productivity is something which we will have to wait and see. But with regard to the food grain reserves, there are enough stocks, there is enough buffer available with the government, and any eventuality arising out of a poor monsoon, the government is fully equipped to deal with it. As of now, it looks that the overall agricultural output is not going to cause the kind of problems or issues which normally one would have expected. Would you like to supplement?
Just to add a few things that remember that the growth forecast for this year is also based on the fact that first oil prices have declined, you know, really dramatically, and that's like a tax cut because the government has passed on about 80% of that to the consumer. That's a huge tax cut which should increase spending. And you, to some extent, you do see that in terms of retail loans. You know, real loans to consumers have gone up, I think, are doing at about 15% now. So the oil cut is one big thing. Second, on the, you know, the cumulative impact of this is important. And remember that the transmission takes place through banks, as the Secretary quite rightly pointed out, but it also takes place through market rates, so that, you know, the combination of repo rate cuts and the expansion of the G-Sec limits is actually putting downward pressure on G-Sec rates as well. And that's also going to have an impact on you know, bank balance sheets and therefore their ability to lend and so on. So and then third, as the Finance Secretary mentioned, you know, part of the strategy in this budget was going to be an increase in public investment, and so far, you know, the numbers are encouraging that, you know, public investment has been high. So I think all in all, you know, these are all positive factors that should help us meet our growth target. But I think we should also acknowledge very honestly that, you know, the international environment is actually pretty challenging, perhaps even more challenging than we expected at the beginning of the year, and that will take some toll on India's growth going forward.
Yeah, 107, please. Yeah.
So this is Gaurav Sinha from Bloomberg TV. Any other questions for the Finance Secretary and for the Economic Affairs Secretary? Sir, first on discounts, so that's an area which the Prime Minister's office is also taking cognizance of. So if we talk a little bit about what the government and the finance industry particularly are doing to avoid the previous crisis for the discounts. Then please, sir, on the bankruptcy law, that's as well, that's something as well which the Finance Secretary and the RBI government have said are crucial to improving. So are you aiming to bring in the bankruptcy law perhaps in the next session of parliament? And if at all, sir, what are what would be the structure you're looking at for this bankruptcy?
Yeah. On the DISCOMs, there's a lot of press coverage on it also today. It's work in progress, in the sense we've been working very closely with the power ministry, and also the affected state governments. There are actually, as you know, about 8 stressed states. In fact, this DISCOM reform is nothing new in the sense it was attempted earlier. There was a lot of progress made. There are about 3 or 4 states which are, I would say, put in the, within apostrophe, badly stressed, where maybe 79% or 70% of this outstandings are really restricted to those few states. Now we are working on some measures how to get around this problem. by also putting certain conditionalities on the states that they have to do some very drastic reforms at that level, because very simply, if you don't pay for power, then things don't work. It sort of clogs up everything down the line. Then coal doesn't work, power's not produced, everything goes haywire. But again, I may, from the finance ministry point of view, I may just mention that we have to be also aware of the you know, the fiscal gains that we've made over the 12th and the 13th Finance Commission, especially in fiscal consolidation at the state level, or the states level, where a lot of good work was done. Now, we have to strike a balance and see that those gains are not, I mean, we just don't cast them aside. Now, that's a tricky kind of situation. As I said, it's work in progress. I think we have meetings every day on this issue, and we are working closely with the affected state governments also. We'll come to some solution.
Siddharth?
On the bankruptcy law, there was the other part of the question. The bankruptcy law, the committee made a presentation before the finance minister, and they have also, we have been interacting, they made a presentation. I have personally held a detailed discussion with them. Before end of this month, before end of October, we expect them to submit their report to the government. Thereafter, the government will examine the report and take necessary action on that to introduce the bill in the parliament.
Sir, if you look at SBI's rate cut, they've reduced home loan rates only by 20 basis points. Sir, here, in front.
Yes.
So SBI has reduced home loan rates only by 20 basis points, and last time it did by 30 basis points. So out of the 125, it's only cut rates for home loan borrowers by about 50 basis points. So, and the idea was to spur demand. So is the government going to step in and ask banks to, you know, pass on the benefits, number one? And number two, on the oil side, how much does the government gain based on the current prices in terms of lower subsidy bill and in terms of higher taxes that it collects this year?
Actually, on the rate
you know
cuts,
the
of course,
Yeah, please. You see, on the rate cuts, as you know, it's the banks have to take their own decision. I mean, there is autonomy in the management of banks, and there is at the same time accountability also lies at the doorsteps of the banks. So therefore, government will not interfere in what exactly is the, you know, how many basis points the banks are passing on. But we have to wait and see what the impact is, and you have to look at the overall scenario. And the small savings aspect also, we have mentioned that the government is reviewing the small savings schemes and the rates. And as the chief economic advisor has also mentioned, the availability of, you know, the increasing the FD, the FII, FPI limits for GSEC investment also eases the pressure on domestic liquidity. So I'm sure the banks will see the overall situation and take a call. And with regard to the investment in the housing sector, the REITs structure, which has been positioned in this year's budget, as a part of this year's budget, that REITs also, we are aware that some entities are, you know, examining that, and they are taking action on that. And I would expect some of the REITs, you know, the that some of the REITs to start functioning very shortly.
Yeah. Last row
there. Sir, this is Manoj from Aaj Tak.
One minute, please hold on.
Oil prices and subsidy budget.
Oil prices and subsidy.
What is the question? They said oil prices coming down, savings and subsidy savings.
Yeah, on the subsidies, there were, well, I can generally answer that question. I think it's there in the press release also. I've mentioned some figures. I mean, the good news is that if you see the subsidy amount as a percentage of GDP has been going down. It's in fact, there's a, of course, there's, it's partly because of the prices of oil are going down. But your major areas where subsidy is spent is fertilizer, food, and of course, petroleum. And petroleum account, I may say, in a sense, has been cleaned up in the sense that diesel, petrol have been deregulated. It's a two-way kind of mechanism. The LPG is also a very simple system now of a direct benefit transfer. We just give a certain amount into the, when you buy a gas cylinder, you pay the market price, but whoever buys it and is an eligible person, he gets a direct benefit transfer through the PEHEL scheme. It, into his or her account. We are now also looking at what to do with kerosene, which is still an area which is on the old under-recovery formula, etc. So in the area of petroleum, I think a lot of work has been done, and we are very comfortable. Even on the fertilizer side, a lot of action was taken, and I think that by the end of the year, you mentioned that there are many ways through efficiency measures we can make a lot of gains, or we can make a lot of savings. In the fertilizer area also, one of the most significant things that the government did was to order that 100% of the fertilizer which comes out of any Indian factory is neem coated, which actually will stop fertilizer from being misused like it was being done earlier. Now that is going to actually help in a lot of savings over there. Then the entire PDS system in the food side is also now being, we are trying to do it on the DBT model. We are working very closely with the food department. So, I mean, all I can say is while subsidies continue to be a large chunk of our expenditure, but we are trying to rationalize the way it is being spent and keep them under control. And apart from that, there are a large number of small subsidies which get in the way of, I'll try to link it up with this issue of transmission of interest rates. It's linked as to what, in fact, the RBI governor had also mentioned that a certain thing has been done and the government has to do certain things, which one of these things has been mentioned. But I found that there are a large number of subsidies that we give out as interest subsidies. Now, these also cause distortion in the interest market. And they come in through various sources. Now, these are schemes which we are re-looking at. I mean, there are various ways of giving a subsidy. Many sectors have to be helped, like textiles, etc. They have to be supported. But then it could go as a VGF. It could go as a capital support. And these are areas where if we clean out the subsidy regime of interest, I think the mechanism of transmission could become even, we could handle it better. So I think I can stop there on the subsidy.
147.
This is Manoj at the back. This is Manoj from Aaj Tak. My question is for Revenue Secretary. You mentioned about the declaration on black money that have been made, the disclosures that have been made. But what happens to those persons who have missed this opportunity as well and have not declared, maybe decided not to declare the black money they have? What happens to those people? What will government do to them?
Well, it is the risk that they have taken, and the moment we find some information about any illegal money kept by them in foreign bank accounts, we would be going after them. That's it.
Yeah, Sapna.
Sapna here. Couple of questions. So we have heard a lot about the RBI rate cut, the fact that there should be a proper transmission interest rates. And in this perspective, government along with RBI is talking about reviewing the small savings mechanism. What we need to understand is that, what is it that you're actually looking at? Are you looking at resetting the formula? Are you also looking at tinkering the tenure of the schemes? And why, sir, small savings of all schemes? Because, India doesn't have a social security net. So is it so important to look at small savings just to make sure that the, interest rate cut transmission amidst the banks, actually takes place? So that's one. Second, so there's also talk about increasing the FDI cap for the private sector banking space. What we did hear from DIBP was that this is not, so to speak, a government proposal, but it's coming from various banks. So, it's work in progress. It's under consultation. When and what can we hear on that, sir? The third aspect, sir, Adhya, sir, you mentioned that there'll be around 50,000 crore shortfall in direct taxes, which will be weighed up by indirect taxes. 14 lakh crores is what you're expecting to garner. So, once the second half of the financial is over, and your indirect tax.
Sapna, sorry to intervene.
Sir, just one last question. Please allow me to complete this.
But let them also absorb by one.
So that is so. Why is it that direct taxes collections? I mean, there could be a shortfall. What does it indicate about corporates basically? And so, do you expect the indirect tax hikes which had happened last fiscal, the impact to start lessening as the financial year progresses because the base effect will set in?
The first two parts of your question, small savings, you have mentioned a social security net, etc. The interest of, as the finance minister has already pointed out, the interest of the small savers, the interest of senior citizens, and the interest of the girl child scheme, all these aspects will be taken into account. The social security component of the small savings scheme is very important. The government will keep that in mind. The other details of the scheme, I will not be able to spell out. You will know about it once the government takes a decision in the matter. With regard to FDI cap on private sector banks, you see, we keep on getting number of suggestions from stakeholders and possible investors and possible recipients of FDI. So all aspects, all such representations and requests are reviewed in the government between the DIPP, Department of Industrial Policy Promotion, and DEA. Wherever necessary, RBI is also consulted. So I would not like to comment on a specific request which has been received, but all requests are reviewed and the government takes a decision.
Yeah, 44 there. Yeah, after we'll come back to you, let others also ask me.
Yeah. Yeah, on the small saving, I may again just add that we will look at it with the, it's just an idea which was put forth. There's nothing, and we'll also see that we have to see that the savings rates, etc., don't come, they don't get impacted. So, as Shakti said, it's there's nothing to get this thing about. It will be handled with absolute nothing has been looked at. It's an idea which has come forth only 3 or 4 days back. In that,
so I hear on your left, Dheeraj from the Economic Times. Question is that after the Indradhanush scheme, we heard from the finance minister that you're looking to change the structure of IDBI, maybe possibly a 49% divestment, bringing down the government stake to 49%. Where do we stand at it right now? And would the similar structure be looking to other public sector banks, given that consolidation has yet not happened in any of the banks? Thank you.
The finance minister has already made a statement, and at this point of time, we have nothing to add. It's a matter which is under discussion. Government will decide as and when decision is taken, you will come to know about it.
Yeah, what?
So, Srivats from Business Line. Couple of questions. One, what is the likely approach that India will take to the OECD's BEPS project? Are we likely to endorse those principles and take that path? And second question is on the HSBC information. Yesterday, the finance minister informed us of the peak balance value of around 6,500 crore. Is that the amount that has been brought to tax, or what is the likely tax collection from that? The OECD is rolling out the BEPS project, and is India going to take a stand that we will support that project and go by those findings?
Of course, we are supporting the OECD effort of BEPS, base erosion and profit shifting agreement, which is piloted by them. It's going to be mutually beneficial for us as well as other countries. Regarding the HSBC, the figure that Finance Minister talked about in his blog is about the assessed income out of the HSBC cases. So the total income which is assessed out of the HSBC cases, and the tax demand which is raised in this assessed cases is of 4,562 crore.
Yes, 62.
If I can just 62. Add on the on the BEPS project, as you know, the BEPS project on which the OECD is working, it's a part of the decision by the G20 leaders, and we have to remember here that India, our officers have played a very active role in various working groups which have given reports, and what constitutes today the report of the OECD on BEPS project. So therefore, our views are duly reflected in most of the working group reports.
Sir, yeah. Prashant from AP. Sir, how are you taking the budget proposals on PDMA, MPC, and as well as the Indian Financial Court? Do you think elaborate on these questions?
You see, the Monetary Policy Committee, the proposals, the government will take a decision very soon. The due procedure for approval, including obtaining cabinet approval, That process is in very advanced stage, and it will be taken forward. And the PDMA proposal already, there is a proposal which is under interministerial circulation. And as and when we get the comments, we expect to get the comments in the next fortnight or so. After that, the government will take a final view to take it forward. And presently, the idea is to start with a non-statutory PDMA, but the remarks of various ministries, including Reserve Bank of India, are awaited, and we will take it forward. IFC is a very comprehensive recommendation, and please remember that IFC, FSLRC, these have to be all seen together, and wherever considered appropriate, the government will take decision, but there is a particular, we have to do them one by one. And one major thing which has happened out of this entire initiative is the merger of the SEBI and the FMC, which has been done very recently.
Yeah, Pooja. Mm.
So the RBI has reduced downwards its projection for this year's growth from 7.6% to 7.4%. The economic survey had made a projection of 8 to 8.5%, and you have just said that growth this year will exceed 7.5%. So can we conclude that the projection that had been made in the economic survey now stands abandoned and growth will be less than 8%?
That's nicely and forcefully put, Pooja. I think the honest answer is that we will reevaluate, the growth projections in a kind of formal, serious way after we get more data, because remember we are getting quite mixed, many encouraging signals and some, of course, challenging signals on the economy. I mean, as the Revenue Secretary just said, indirect tax revenues, even without the additional measures, is growing at 12.2%. So that's, and when we do these numbers, we know that for indirect tax revenues, tax buoyancy has been less than one traditionally. So if that's the case, the underlying base is growing, relatively strongly. And similarly, direct tax revenue of 12% is not to be something to be sneezed at. Real deposits are growing, real credit is growing. So what this will all amount to at the end of the day, whether it's going to be 8, 7.5, 7.8, is a bit early for us to take a strong view on. Let the second quarter data come in, and then we'll get you a more precise estimate.
Yeah, Manu.
Sir, following this RBI's decision to hike this FII's cap in government bonds, do you see are we ready to move on the earlier pending proposal to make the government's bond compatible with the Euroclear? Euroclear, sir.
No, at the moment, there is no such proposal.
Thank you.
Yeah, 39, please.
Drishti from Bloomberg News. Sir, can you briefly outline the roadmap for disinvestment you have prepared, and does that include Sooty's stake sale as well as Hindustan Zinc and Balco? Also, are you expecting a shortfall in disinvestment proceeds this year?
See, on the roadmap of disinvestment, we would not like to give, because we would not like to mention which companies and when, because immediately the market reacts. And as you know, the moment there is an announcement that a particular scrip, the government is considering disinvestment, the market, given its periodic volatility, the share prices do tend to come down. The market expects a higher arbitrage. So therefore, which scrip, when, we will not be able to announce in advance. That is a matter of strategy. And as and when government takes a decision, it will be announced and it will be then quickly put through. As you know, now it is T+2. So therefore, it will be announced and it will be put through. With regard to the shortfall, I think we have already explained that the effort is to maximize the receipts. So let us see what is the year-end figure.
Yeah, 33.
Sir, Arup from Business Standard. This is just an extension of some of the questions which my colleagues asked. By all indications, this has been a good year, commodity price. And you don't anticipate the massive spending cuts that we saw in previous years. At the same time, you have increased capital expenditure quite a bit. What lessons does this draw for the next year? Next year, will you be able to the fiscal path? And at the same time, with the additional burden of OROP and mission, will you be actually able to maintain this commitment or even increase this commitment to increase public spending and expenditure?
Yeah, the short answer is yes. We have taken that into account.
95, yeah.
It is both.
But I mean, from hasn't happened for retail specifically. It hasn't happened.
Okay, let me reply now. It is both. And if getting the retail investors back into the market was so easy, it would have happened yesterday. So, having said that, I would like to add that the government's thinking is also to restructure, restructure the way the public sector functions. It's not just disinvesting and getting the numbers. The belief is that disinvestment brings in higher levels of accountability on the part of the public sector company managements. And whenever discussions and decisions are taken with regard to individual companies, due attention, in fact, great attention is given to the management structure of the particular public sector company and how it should be made more efficient. And with regard to the optimism level continues, but we have to be realistic and plan for the rest part of the, you know, for the remaining 6 months of the current year and also for the next year. With regard to getting the retail investors back into the, you know, into the market, that is something which on which a number of steps have been taken, and we will continue to take similar measures. It is under discussion with SEBI also, so government will decide.
Yeah, 50. Yeah, I will start with this. Yeah.
So coming back to black money once again, sir. Finance Minister has also said on his Facebook post that a bulk of black money still lies in India and that we are going to incentivize people very soon about the use of plastic currency. So can you throw some light on what kind of incentives the government is thinking about on domestic black money?
It's work in progress. As soon as we are ready with some announcement, we'll let you know.
Just on that, just a terminological thing, I think that the aim is to move away from a cashless economy, but that doesn't mean, doesn't only mean more plastic money. I think we also need all forms of mobile payment, wallet, e-things. So just to make it clear that cashless doesn't mean just more plastic. It means all other forms of payment.
Yeah.
Sir,
yeah, please.
Ajay from Doordarshan News. Sir, centrally sponsored scheme ko rationalize karne ka aapne kaha, uske upar kabhi kya update hai aur kuch numbers de sakte hain agar niti aayog ke saath agar kuch final baat hui hai to.
Dekhiye uske andar anuj ek committee chief minister of Madhya Pradesh ke niche baithi thi. Unhone apna sara recommendation wagera bhi taiyar kar liya, report ban gayi hai, wo niti ke paas hai. उसके अंदर वो लास्ट स्टेजेस के हो गए पे है, जब वहाँ से आएगा उसमें देखेंगे. मगर इंटरिम ने हमने क्या किया है कि जितनी ये स्कीम्स थी 75-25 बेसिस के ऊपर बांटा जाता था पैसा, उसको हमने 50-50 कर दिया है. इसके बाद जो कुछ भी कंसेंसस होगा, जो डिसीजन होगा एवेंचुअली तो कैबिनेट लेवल पर जाएगा, हम उसके ऊपर अमल करेंगे. मगर इसके अंदर एक और चीज़ मैं आपके ध्यान में लाना चाहूँगा कि जितने ये स्पेशल कैटेगरी स्टेट्स थे जहाँ 90-10 के बेसिस के ऊपर दिया, 14 स्टेट्स थे, उनको हमने वहाँ के उस स्कीम्स के ऊपर कोई तब्दीली नहीं की है. तो काम चल रहा है. ठीक.
या अनुज.
सर, अनुज गुप्ता नवभारत से. सर,
जो मुद्रा सप्ताह अभी मनाया गया उसमें कितना लोन डिस्पर्स किया गया सर? ये मैं इसलिए पूछ रहा हूँ क्योंकि 25 तारीख को शाम को 4 बजे जो वेबसाइट पर जो डाटा दिया हुआ था, 26 को जब नोट किया तो वो 25 से कम था, तो मुझे लगा शायद वो डाटा में कहीं कुछ गड़बड़ी हो रही होगी, बाद में वो बढ़ा जरूर है। और दूसरा, जो सॉवरिन गोल्ड कॉइन इस साल लॉन्च करने की जो FM ने घोषणा की थी उसके बारे में कुछ बता पाएंगे?
Sir, as on today, we have put the figures on the website. The total disbursements under the three categories, Sishu, Kishore and Tarun, the total number of accounts is 43.55 lakh, and the total amount disbursed is 26,582 crore.
Sir, Asim this side from...
Gold coin ke baare mein aapne poocha, usme action has already been taken. MMTC, which usually prepares these gold coins, they have taken action. And date of release and launching, abhi bahut turant, bahut shortly it will be announced.
Yeah, Asim. Yes, sir. Last year the spectrum auction has contributed significantly to your revenue. What are your expectations from this year? Spectrum auction and telecom sector from this year.
देखिए, बजट में जो टू कंपोनेंट्स होता है आउटसाइड टैक्स, एक है नॉन टैक्स रेवेन्यू, दूसरा है नॉन डेट कैपिटल रिसीट्स। उस दोनों में जो बजट में जो फिगर्स दिया गया है बजट एस्टीमेट में, बोथ द नंबर्स विल बी अचीव्ड। दोनों हम इंटरनली रिव्यू कर रहे हैं। स्पेक्ट्रम के बारे में तुरंत फिलहाल मैं आई विल नॉट बी एबल टू मेंशन बिकॉज इट इज़ आई थिंक वन और टू डिसीजंस आर टू बी टेकन वेरी शॉर्टली। बट FM auction के बारे में आपको पता है, सो आई जस्ट वॉन्ट टू रिमाइंड यू दैट थ्रू FM auction वी हैव गवर्नमेंट हैज कंडक्टेड ए वेरी सक्सेसफुल auction।
वील टेक अ लास्ट टू थ्री क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम द लास्ट रो। आई थिंक मोस्ट ऑफ यू आर फीलिंग वेरी हंग्री एंड ऑल्सो रेवेन्यू सेक्रेटरी वुड लाइक टू मेक एन अनाउंसमेंट। आई थिंक दैट यू विल बी लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड टू। लेट्स गो टू 98।
सर, दिस इज चेतन फ्रॉम ब्लूमबर्ग टीवी इंडिया। सर, I would like to ask you on the detailed roadmap that the government is planning to take on removing corporate tax exemptions, and by how much time will the government reduce corporate tax rate in the first year, considering a direct tax will be below target in this fiscal?
No, actually, yes, within the sectors there would be some changes. Some taxes may yield more money than what we are expecting. Some may yield less money than what we are expecting. But the overall figure which I have given you is quite correct. And we should be able to offset some of the losses in direct tax by the gains in the indirect tax, and some of the losses in the corporate income tax by the gain in the other types of direct taxes. So this is broadly, I've already given you an indication that we would be achieving the target.
Yeah. Sir, Girish from Financial Express. Yeah. Sir, we have been in the process of renegotiating our double tax avoidance agreement with Mauritius. I would like to know how far, what is the progress so far achieved?
Well, we are in discussion with them, and some negotiations had already taken place, and they wanted to reopen some issues, and we are still resisting it, and we are in discussion with them.
Yeah, last but one question. Yeah, yeah. You can ask. Yeah.
Sir, as you have also mentioned, the profit is expectedly less than what is estimated in the survey, and the inflation will also be low as expected. So, obviously, the nominal growth rate will be low. So, don't you think that will be a challenge in making the fiscal deficit target? One. Sir, the second thing is that the Supreme Court has put restrictions on the use of Aadhaar for the subsidy, DBT use or in DBT.
On the Arvind, you can answer the thing on the growth thing which we are mentioning. But all I might say is that I think what the inflation target which the RBI has set has been for January, they were talking about 6%.
Yeah.
This thing. So I'm not anticipating any great shortfalls in revenue in that sense. what he's saying that low growth, low inflation means less revenue. But I don't think that.
No, I think the point is a good one, that, you know, a nominal GDP growth is going to be a little bit less than we had estimated in the survey and also the basis for the budget projections. And so, you know, anytime nominal GDP growth is less, you know, it's going to have some implications. But I think the key thing is what the Revenue Secretary said, that notwithstanding that, we are very close to meeting our revenue projections. And you know, part of it was because, you know, the additional measures on the indirect tax side have compensated for, you know, any possible slowdown on the direct tax side. On Aadhaar, can I just say one thing? Yeah, on Aadhaar, I think that as you saw yesterday, several state governments, the government, several state governments, several regulatory agencies have made a petition to the Supreme Court to clarify that ruling, and that's going to be the first plank going forward in terms of trying to, you know, be able to use this for the other subsidy schemes. So I think the government has taken action in that regard, precisely for the reason that you mentioned.
Yeah, last question.
Sir, good afternoon. Siddharth from Bloomberg News. My question is to Mr. Shaktikant Das, Economic Affairs Secretary. Sir, the Finance Minister had announced in the Parliament that the government is committed to setting up an independent PDMA and would announce a detailed roadmap about that. And have you been able to resolve your differences with Reserve Bank of India on this issue? The differences with the RBI on PDMA and a detailed roadmap PDMA. FM had indicated in Parliament and its commitment to set up an independent PDMA.
See, whatever the Finance Minister has announced on the floor of the Parliament will be implemented and that will be followed. With regard to differences, etc., which you are pointing out with RBI, if you recall, I had earlier mentioned during today's, little while earlier, that the proposal is under interministerial and interagency consultation. We are also awaiting the remarks of the Reserve Bank of India. They will be taken into account. And let me assure you and all of you, stating that there is very good understanding between the Finance Ministry and the Reserve Bank of India on various issues, including PDMA.
Now the Revenue Secretary will make an announcement.
No, there is a small announcement about the farmers issue that we have taken a decision about. Providing effective protection to the domestic industry and even to the domestic farm sector has become a big issue in view of the global meltdown, because there is a glut of supply of most of the commodities in some other countries. Now India has to also take care of its own local industry and the local farm. There was a request received from the milk producers of the country saying that there is a big drop in the price of ghee, butter and butter oil in the international market. So we have taken a decision starting from today for a period of 6 months. We would be increasing the import duty on ghee, butter and butter oil from the present rate of 30% to 40%. So this is going to continue up to 31st of March 2016. And a notification in this regard is being issued today itself. I would also like to suggest that there are a lot of industries which are approaching Revenue Department with a request to make changes in the duty structure in order to give them effective protection. My suggestion to them would be that they should effectively use the mechanism of safeguard as well as anti-dumping, which is there in the country. Unfortunately, in the safeguard and anti-dumping, both this mechanism, it is not for us to take suo moto action. The industry has to make out a case for imposition of safeguard or for anti-dumping. If it is against a particular country and a particular product, they can go to the Commerce Ministry, the Director General of Anti-Dumping, and they have to make an application, and then there is a process to be followed there. If they file an application, there is also a provision for imposing provisional duty by the safeguard. Safeguard, Director Safeguard can suggest to the Revenue Department that even the provisional, pending the finalization of anti-dumping procedure, the provisional duty can also be imposed. So the revenue department can only act when there is a recommendation from the anti-dumping directorate. Similarly, in the safeguard also, there is a provision that if there is a sudden spurt of import for a particular commodity from all over the world into the country, and if it is likely to cause domestic damage to the domestic industry, then the safeguard director can recommend it to the revenue department, and we can then take an appropriate decision. As you know, recently we had invoked the safeguard duty of 20% in case of hot rolled steel industry. And so we are very conscious of the fact that the domestic industry may need some protection for the time being, looking at the global situation, and we are open to that idea. But the industry has to also approach the respective authority with full justification of the demand. Thank you very much.
Friends, after this very large comprehensive press conference, there will not be one-to-one with the secretaries, making a small announcement. Okay. And kindly join us for high snacks on fourth floor, please. And thank you for